Good evening and welcome to the Sports Advantage. I'm your host, Andrew Epperson, and with us today, right after the break, Pete Roulier, familiar face, and then obviously Seth Campbell, the quarterback. Heath Land was supposed to be here, didn't pan out. Seth stepping in the clutch like always, gentlemen. So let's get started here. The NBA is what we're going to start with. College football is over with, for better or for worse, mostly for worse, because let's be honest, it's what we really love to watch. So let's go to the East. The Cleveland Cavaliers fired their head coach, David Blatt, and to put this into perspective, David Blatt and the Cavaliers had the best record in the Eastern Conference when they fired him. Pete, was it justified that the Cavaliers fired their head coach?
Was it justified? I'd say no, but was it the right move? I guess I'd say yes, because obviously they're going to do what LeBron wants them to do in this situation. I don't think that you can fire the winningest coach in the East right now, but considering the circumstances, I think it was definitely a good move. I think David Blatt might be a good coach, honestly. We've just never seen like him actually coach. It's been LeBron's team the whole time. Obviously, he won a lot of games in Europe, and it's a different animal. So, obviously, the Cavaliers organization thought they saw something in him, and I'm sure another team will see something in him and actually give him a chance to coach a basketball team. So, it wasn't justified, but it's probably the right move.
Well, those are some good points there. Seth, what do you think?
I think if it was any other team, that Blatt probably absolutely wouldn't be fired right now. I think because it was LeBron, it is LeBron's team, no doubt about it. I mean, he runs the show, so if LeBron wants him to be gone, then I think he's going to be gone. So I think it was the right move for the Cavaliers because they got to cater to LeBron.
Well, I agree 100%, and I think if LeBron James wants the Cleveland Cavaliers to change their name to the Cleveland LeBrons, heck, just do it. It's LeBron James, everybody. It's LeBron.
Absolutely.
So I 100% agree with you. LeBron James, his happiness means more than David Blatt's happiness. That's for sure. And if you really watch the Cavaliers play, you notice that Tyronn Lue, who is stepping in as the new coach, that he was pretty much calling all the shots as it was anyway. I mean, it really felt like it was LeBron and Tyronn Lue, and David Blatt was just kind of sitting there like this, you know, just sitting on the bench like this. And so I think that really it's not going to change anything. One thing that does get me, though, is that Tyronn Lue is coaching in the All-Star game. I mean, the man has coached, two games?
He's the best coach in the East because they got the best record, right?
Well, I guess so. I mean, he definitely adopted a good situation.
He's got a 66% winning percentage so far. So.
Hey, I mean, that's probably better than anybody else. Other than another team's winning percentage that we're going to move to now. The Golden State Warriors obviously are on pace to beat the greatest record of all time for a single season, which is held by the 95-96 Bulls. And I think we all know who played for that team, right? Scottie Pippen. Steve Kerr was their coach last season whenever they won it all. If you don't know that the Warriors won the championship last season, you've been living under a rock because ESPN talks about them left and right. We don't do that here on the Sports Advantage, except for now. Luke Walton stepped in at the beginning of the season and just went on an unrealistic winning streak. I mean, it was crazy. You began to wonder if they were going to lose a game, you know? And so are Steve Kerr and Luke Walton really that good of coaches? Or is Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, Draymond Green, obviously the greatest player ever, Andrew Bogut, are they just making both of these coaches look better than they really are? Pete, what do you think?
Absolutely, yes, of course they are. But Mark Jackson had the same squad pretty much, I guess, minus the new and improved Draymond Green. But yeah, obviously they got Steph Curry out there who's doing ridiculous things. There's really nothing to talk about when it comes to him. You just have to watch and see that this kid is the real deal, and he can't be stopped by anybody. You could put any coach in the NBA on the Warriors, and they'd still be on this amazing streak. But all credit to the coaches. They've, if you think about the finals last year, Steve Kerr putting Iguodala in the starting lineup. That was a great call. Obviously, they're good coaches, but no, I mean, obviously, again, Steph Curry and Klay Thompson and that squad are making them look like the greatest of all time, which they're not.
Well, I think Byron Scott would still have a losing record if he was up there, but that's, you know.
That's what all Lakers fans would say.
Yeah, that's true. Seth, what do you think? Do you think that these guys are actually good coaches, or do you think that the Warriors are just the Warriors?
I mean, obviously it helps to have guys that are that good. It obviously can't hurt. But yeah, I think Steph and his squad are most definitely better players. They make the team. If this team didn't have those guys, if they didn't have Steph, it all revolves around him. So if they didn't have him, then this team wouldn't be as good as they are right now. Yes, Steve Kerr and Luke Walton can coach and coach really well, but you have Steph Curry. I don't even know if he misses. Like, if you watch ESPN, he sure doesn't. So coaching that guy right there just makes it that the Warriors are made because of Steph Curry.
Well, if you watch ESPN, you'd think that Steph Curry has never missed a shot.
Yes.
And you'd think that Riley Curry has never missed a shot. But, you know, that's just ESPN for you.
She plays on the team, right?
Apparently. I mean, you watch ESPN, his whole family plays for him. I mean, and they all start, and they all average 50 points a game. Right. I mean, it's incredible. It's really great stats there from the Currys.
He doesn't only make the coaches better, but he makes the players around him so much better. I don't think anybody would even know Draymond Green's name if he wasn't on this team. That's just personal opinion. Obviously, some people would think he's a great player, but Steph Curry just makes the team, the coaches, the organization, the Golden Gate Bridge hold up. He does everything.
Something that is surprising to me about Curry is this kid came from Davidson. You know, and he had a great run in the NCAA tournament, and if he doesn't have that run, then there's a good possibility that he may not even been discovered. You know, and that's that Davidson run there that you never really know who can really be a great player, and he's turned out to be magnificent.
This last year, I thought that he was just on a tear. I was like, when is he going to cool down? Like, Steph Curry is not the real deal. But we're a season and a half in for one of the most outstanding runs in NBA history, and I guess I'm sold on him. I don't like it because I don't think he's taking good shots, but I can't help but say, like, I want Steph Curry on my team. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I'd love for him to be a Laker, that's for sure. But fact is, obviously, last season I looked at Steve Kerr and I said, wow, this guy's taken over a team that the season before had made a deep run in the playoffs before losing. And I just thought, really, I thought he was overrated last season, if I'm going to be honest. And I was absolutely proven right whenever I saw Luke Walton go on that huge streak. I love Luke Walton, okay? I love the man. But come on. But now that I look back at Mark Jackson, I wonder, wow, if he wasn't able to do it with this team, like you said, Draymond Green obviously was not the Draymond Green we know now. Whenever I look at them, I looked at them then, I say, wow, maybe Mark Jackson really wasn't that good because this team is just amazing. You know what I mean? Could they have done it with anybody else but Mark Jackson? So, I mean, that's a whole different question altogether, but, I mean, it's really a question that needs to be asked, you know?
Well, Steph Curry isn't the same player that he was 2 years ago, and neither is Klay Thompson. So you got to take that into consideration. I think if Mark Jackson was coaching this team, they'd still be on this incredible run. They'd probably win the World Series. They probably win the NBA championship. It's just the way that the Warriors are playing right now. They can't be stopped.
I'd be hard to agree with you. If Luke Walton can do it, then I'm sure Mark Jackson can do it right. All right, so continuing to talk about the Warriors here. The Warriors clearly head and shoulders above everybody else. They played the Spurs without Tim Duncan and Danny Green, and they just obliterated the Spurs. But you look at the Spurs on top of that, and that's the number two team in the league. And they're both in the West playing against fantastic competition week in and week out. And they're both leading the league statistically in the win category. So is there any chance that somebody, maybe from the West, maybe the Cavaliers in the finals if they do meet, could anybody beat either of these teams in a seven-game series? We've started with you this whole night, Pete, so let's go to Seth. What do you think?
Simple answer is no. I don't see any team that could compete with these two teams. You saw how the Spurs were manhandled by the Warriors last week, a few days ago, and so I don't think there's any team that could come close to them.
What do you think, Pete?
I'm with Seth. No one's going to beat the Warriors if they continue to play the way they've been playing
Well, I would tend to agree with that too. But if anybody is going to do it, I'm going to say it's the Thunder. They beat the Spurs in the first game of the season for any team. But obviously, the Spurs have grown into a team that's completely different than they were then. They've gotten LaMarcus Aldridge involved. That 7'3 center who they drafted, Boban, he's been amazing, surprisingly amazing as well. So they've grown, and I think that they would still beat the Thunder in a seven-game series if they played. But if anybody is going to do it, I would say that it's going to be the Thunder. But it's not. Nobody's going
to
do it.
That would be a fun series to watch.
That would be a fun series, and it might just happen. We'll just have to see. All right, so I don't want to ask this question because I already know both of y'all's answers, and it's going to hurt my feelings. But Kobe Bryant is starting in the All-Star game. Leads, he's the best in NBA history in an All-Star game. He has scored more points than anybody else. That's over Michael Jordan, Kareem. I mean, just so many great players, and he has more points than all of them. And he got voted in as a starter. Obviously, this season has not gone Kobe's way. Battling, he's been sitting out several times, you know, probably once or twice a week usually, and whenever he does get in, his field goal percentage is, comparable to the Razorback basketball team's shooting percentage at some point. So, Pete, what would you say? Do you think it is justified that he's in the All-Star game, or do you think that it was the wrong move?
Well, considering that it was fan votes, then I guess it is justified. The fans voted for him, but obviously he shouldn't be a starter in the All-Star game. The numbers just aren't there. He's washed up. Like you said, he sits like one or two games a week. And there's players out there that are doing incredible things, like, not incredible things, I'll take that back. But if Kobe's name was, say, Courtney Lee, or if Kobe's name was, I don't know, Eric Bledsoe, would he be in the All-Star game? Absolutely not. Not a chance.
Well, that's because his name is not Eric Bledsoe or Courtney Lee. This is the man, as we saw, scored 81 points. If Courtney Lee scores 81 points, I will
absolutely eat my truck. That was like 10 years ago, though.
It's still great. It's still great.
It's still great 10 years ago. This is 2016.
And it's still marvelous. Seth, what do you think?
Well, I think it goes back to what is the All-Star game now? Is the All-Star game going to be this game where we go back and we remember these great players for what they were? Or is the All-Star game really going to be to where we take the talent, the best talent in the NBA or any league, and actually watch them play against each other? Kobe's not the best. I mean, yes, I will give it to you, Andrew, that Kobe has had some good years. But this year, he's not All-Star game material. So I just don't see it. I don't see it. And you know, it's kind of a shame because he took somebody's spot, you know, that probably could have deserved it.
Right.
But they are paying tribute to him.
Here's my case. If we're talking about legacy and why he should be in the game, then why is Tim Duncan not in the All-Star game? He's had a much better career than Kobe, but he's had a better career than Kobe overall. Tim Duncan's probably the greatest power forward of all time.
That's true. I wouldn't say that he's
But he's not even a reserve.
I don't understand why he's in either. It feels like the Spurs are overlooked year in and year out for something. Always something. I think people just forgot about him almost.
And the Lakers are not overlooked. I guess you could say they're just overrated, maybe.
They're not overrated. I would just say that the Lakers have more fans in the world than
LA.
Anybody else. So people naturally care more about them than anywhere else.
Bandwagon fans.
That happens
bandwagon
when you live in do. LA, though.
That's true. Well, Fayetteville's comparable to LA if you really think about it, right?
In no
I'm
way
sure
whatsoever.
There's a star who's been here. Ben Rector's been here, right? I mean, he counts. But come on. He deserves to be in the All-Star game. Fans voted him in. They want to see him there. One last ride for Kobe Bean Bryant. They want to see him put on a show in the All-Star game. Look, if the All-Star game actually meant something, I would say, okay, no, he does not belong in this. You can look away all you want, Pete, but if it actually, like the MLB, right? The All-Star game means something. These players actually care about playing in it because it
means
something.
You're saying it doesn't mean something to other players?
It doesn't. NBA? Well, I mean, like,
that,
maybe
that,
like
that
the
spot
first
that he took.
In, but what is it, like, if their team wins a game, what does it matter? You know, like, nothing happens.
Yeah, but give nothing. The young players a shot.
They'll get their shot once Kobe's done. They'll get it.
That's just unfair.
Yeah. Sometimes life is unfair, Pete. You'll learn that real quick.
On to the next one.
Speaking of the All-Star game, some people got snubbed, and Kobe was not one of them. So who is your biggest All-Star snub? Possibly, like, you look at some of these starters, and some of these guys don't belong as starters. You can say Kobe Bryant in that. But yes. For me, Jimmy Butler is the guy who got snubbed. Because he was not a starter, right? I mean, he should have been a starter. And Dwayne Wade, his stats, 18.7 points per game, about 5 rebounds a game, and 4.6 assists a game, and 4 rebounds a game. And then you look at Jimmy Butler, and you see 22 points a game, 4 assists, 5 rebounds. Better stats. Pete, Who is your All-Star starter?
Why did you just say that?
Because
you just had a, you just went off about Kobe Bryant, and you're talking about Dwayne Wade, who's actually can still play.
Dwayne Wade isn't retiring, though. There's the difference right there. Kobe Bryant is retiring. This is the last chance he could get in.
All right. Anyway, we're just gonna move past that. I think the biggest All-Star snub in terms of starters, in terms of reserve, is Marc Gasol, without a doubt. I think he's the second best center in the NBA. But the All-Star snub for starters was DeMarcus Cousins. I don't get why they don't have a starting center on both teams. I think that would make more sense if they did it that way. And DeMarcus Cousins has had the breakout year that we've all been waiting for. And even greater than that. What, he put up like 56 a couple of days ago?
And then before 44. That, 48 or
and
something.
And he's been
like
playing
that.
Great all year with that, with a team that's not even that great. I mean, he's got Rondo, who's making a comeback, I guess you
could
say
that. Cauley Stein's been playing well, too.
Yeah, but they don't have a true center in the starting lineup, and I'd say Cousins deserves to be in there way more than Kobe. You know what I mean? DeMarcus Cousins, I think DeMarcus Cousins is a top five player in the NBA right now, East or West, and I think he got snubbed for the starters.
Well, I would tend to agree with you on that.
Jimmy Butler also got snubbed. I'd agree with that.
Right. What do you think, Seth?
Tim Duncan, you know, mentioned him earlier. He's not in the game. If we're going to make the All-Star game this place where we remember the great players, they like Kobe, then I think that he should most definitely be in the game.
All right, so we have covered the NBA, gentlemen, and whenever we get back, we got some football to talk about here on the Sports Advantage. Welcome back to the Sports Advantage. I told you we were going to talk about some football whenever we came back, and I was right. We're about to. So, Steven Gutskowski and the Patriots, I don't think I've ever heard them be introduced that way, right? they lost to the Broncos, AFC Championship game. Pretty surprising, really. But Gutskowski, the kicker, he missed an extra point early in the game, and the Patriots obviously had to go for a two-point conversion at the end and failed. I'm going to have both of y'all answer this question here momentarily, but we are joined by the quarterback, Heath Land. He has decided to make an appearance, could not make it here tonight, but he is at his loft. He's a quarterback, so he plays in the NFL. What do you think, Heath?
That's right. I'm reporting live from my random office here. my thoughts on it was extremely crucial. He missed it, and it was a big part of the game. And in large part, yes, he is to blame. But even if he had made it, he still would have had to hit the game-winning field goal in the fourth quarter. That was inevitable, even if he had made that. So, you know, in a way, he made two field goals that game. He was a large part of why they're in it. But I still say that, you know, extra point, you've got to hit that to give your chance a team to win, or give your team a chance to win.
Well, we appreciate that commentary, Heath. And you need to tell me the name of your interior designer, because I'd love to give him a call, have my apartments all refurnished. That'd be just great. What do you think here, Pete? Was it old Stevie's fault that the Patriots lost the game?
I would say, yes, it was old Stevie's fault they lost the football game. He missed the extra point, and they were down by two. Game on the line, all they had to do was kick another field goal, and they would have tied the game, gone to OT. There's no way Peyton Manning could have drove the Broncos down, so if the Patriots got the ball with all that momentum, I think the Patriots would have definitely won that game in overtime. So, he's to blame. I don't see how you could argue it any other way. All he's got to do is do one job. Didn't he make, 400 in a row before that or something like that?
Incredible record before that.
I mean, it's as simple as that. You have one job, make the extra point, and you're good to go. So, it's his fault.
Come on, even Rob Branscombe would have made that kick.
Oh,
Seth,
no.
What do you think?
Oh, no.
Do you think it's old Steven Gutskowski's fault, or whose fault would it be if not?
I don't know. I think the Patriots had multiple opportunities throughout the game to make up for Gostkowski's missed extra point. Yes, he is a kicker. Yes, that is his job. And you think it is one of the most simplest jobs that a kicker can have. You know, after every touchdown, you're going to kick an extra point. Did he miss one during the regular season? I don't think he did. Did he?
And I don't think he's missed one in the regular season for like years.
So I don't know if you can necessarily blame it on him. He hasn't missed. He's been a great kicker for you for his entire career. So I don't think you necessarily put the blame on him for missing one. I think the Patriots should have capitalized on a few more of their possessions.
Well, for me, I think it's the offensive line's fault. And clearly, they were not blocking. Tom Brady just felt flustered all game. You could see it in his face. And obviously, the Patriots agree with me because they fired their offensive line coach, right?
So that's why you're the expert.
That's why I'm the expert. I called it. I'm the one who called Bill Belichick and told him to fire him. And it happened. So, I don't know. You can blame it on me. Who knows? So, Peyton Manning, one of the greatest quarterbacks of all time. Playing in the Super Bowl again. He missed pretty much all the season, but he's about to play in the Super Bowl. If he wins this one, he's had some trouble winning the big games. If he wins this one, is he going to go up on your greatest list of all time? Let's ask the quarterback himself, all the way from his loft over on in Harlem himself. Heath, what do you think? Is he going to go up on your list, or is he going to stay where he is?
He's always been one of my favorite quarterbacks, first off. And to me, in a lot of ways, he's already extremely high on my list. He's already set a lot of the career marks for a quarterback in the NFL. So in a lot of ways, he's right up there. I will say, if he wins the Super Bowl, it'd be a great way to ride it in the sunset. And I think he inevitably has to be in at least everybody's top five. He's in my top three just from his career marks and the records that he set. But definitely, definitely, if he gets this, I don't think there's any denying that he needs to be in anybody's top five, at least.
Well, for me, I think that little end table over there at your loft is top five for me. I've never seen something that incredible. And I'm telling you, just give me your interior designer's number. I'm going
to
call him.
I'll be sure to do that.
Pete, what do you think? Is he going to go up in your list?
Well, it's hard to argue with the quarterback all the way in Harlem. I would have to say that, no, he's not. Peyton Manning, I think, has hurt the team in these playoffs more than he's helped the team. I've been an Osweiler fan ever since he stepped in as a starting role. The thing about Peyton Manning that is hurting the team is if even one defensive lineman or a linebacker gets through the offensive line, he's turning around and sprinting backwards. There's no shot of him even making a play or even throwing the ball out of bounds. He's so immobile. He can't even throw the ball more than 30 yards down the field. He's getting these sacks on first and second down and making them on long third downs. He can't even get the ball all the way to the first down marker. So I think he's hurting the team more than he's helping the team. No doubt he's a top five quarterback. I do agree with that. But he's not going to go up in my legacy. If the Broncos win, obviously it was their defense, and that's what I'm going to remember.
What do you think, Seth?
I think he is a top five quarterback, but if he wins, no, he doesn't go up. This season, in part, needs to go to Osweiler. I mean, he needs to be a very high candidate for MVP to keep the season together.
That's bold, Seth.
To keep the season together. Why not, you know? Coming in off the bench is not an easy job. Obviously, if they didn't have their defense that they have, then I don't even know if they make the playoffs. So the defense obviously has helped Peyton. Without them, they would be nowhere. So I'm sorry to disagree with you, Heath, but no, I don't think he goes up.
How could you do that to him? He's been traveling Brooklyn this whole week.
What are you going to do, Heath? Come over here and hurt me?
Yeah, he can't do it. He's in New York. He can't do anything.
Send me a
hot dog, Heath. Anyway,
they're pretty good over here.
Peyton Manning's comfortably at number four or five as greatest quarterbacks of all time. And after missing a big old fat chunk of the season, that's not going to really mean anything to me if he wins it. That defense is one of the greatest possibly in NFL history. That is a fantastic defense. They have won in spite of quarterback play. And, it'd be great for him to win another one to tie his brother, old Eli. You can say hi to him while you're in New York.
Because he's in New York.
Because he's in New York. But anyway, that's my take on it. All right, so we've got a couple questions left, about 4 minutes. Can the Broncos defense, we've already talked about them, elite, can they stop what has just been an exciting Panthers offense? Let's talk to the offensive man himself over in New York. Keith, what do you think?
I think no. I think they can slow him down in that offense down, but there is no stopping that offense, especially right now. They're absolutely on a roll, and they've been tearing up top defenses, you know, deep in the playoffs. So, no, I don't think there's any stopping them. I do think there's a possibility they slow them down enough for the Broncos to have a large chance of winning this game. But at the same time, if I had to bet on it, I'd go with the Panthers in this one, despite my allegiance to Peyton Manning.
Well, thank you there, Heath. We certainly appreciate it. Pete, what do you think?
I think if the Broncos offense can get first downs. I think that's obviously key, because if Cam Newton's on the field two times more than Peyton Manning's on the field, Cam Newton's going to make plays. And if they get off to a quick start, Peyton Manning's not going to be able to bring him back. That's just not who he is anymore. So I think that I think they can slow him down, like you said, but I don't think they're going to be able to stop him unless the Broncos are moving the ball on offense.
Seth, what do you think, real quick?
I think if there was a defense that could stop the Panthers, that it would be this Denver defense. But I just think right now the Panthers are just an absolute beast on offense. And so they may can stop them. And I'm not saying that the Broncos don't have a chance, but I think the Panthers' offense is just incredible right now.
Well, my dad's going to appreciate this because he's a Broncos fan. I think that the Broncos, in fact, do stop the Panthers' offense. I think that those corners, Harris, a lot of those guys down there, Aqib Talib, just some great, great players on defense. And they're matched up against some receivers who have been really effective this season but have not seen a defense like that. And I just think it's going to be too much. So there you go, Dad. I think the Broncos win the Super Bowl. All right, so about a minute left. Real quick, Thomas Davis is playing with a broken arm. He's the linebacker for the Carolina Panthers, and which is kind of crazy that he's going to try to play in the Super Bowl with a broken arm. We'll leave Heath over in New York. He can go on and play on his phone now. What do you think? What do you think, Pete? Okay, could you play with a broken arm? Is it possible?
Could I play with a broken arm?
Could you do it?
If it was a Super Bowl, well, I don't know what to say. I would never be in that position, obviously. I mean, look at me. I'm not Thomas Davis. But I think if they say, if they even gave him the slightest, like, go-ahead, I think he's going to go for it. Carolina Panthers, their defense is known for being tough, and Thomas Davis is a tough guy. I'm sure he's going to go ahead and try to do it. I don't know if it's going to hurt the team or help the team, but we'll see.
What do you think, Seth, real quick?
If it was up to me, I couldn't do it, but I respect the guy for trying. I mean, it is a Super Bowl, so you might as well try, see what can happen. I mean,
you never know how many Super Bowls you're going to get to.
Yeah, that's work so hard this entire season and to get to this point, and then you get to it and you can't play because of a broken arm. If you can tape it up enough, man, go for it.
Well, I agree with you. I think it's very just great that he's going to try to play. It shows that he's a great teammate and a hard worker. And we'll definitely look forward to seeing him there if he's able to do it. But anyway, that is it here on the Sports Advantage. We've had some fun. Heath, thanks again for checking in. And we will see you guys next week, of course. Same time, same place here on the Sports Advantage.